Cooke and I met in January, we both felt it was really important to focus on sustainability, climate change, biodiversity, and on turning our conversation into action in the Birmingham workplace. I remember Jenny, there was a throwaway comment from Jenny. She said, the atmosphere doesn't know what promises you've made. So there's something in that about, it's not just talking about it, it's not just making promises, we actually need to make change. What seemed an important topic then seems all the more important now with the opportunity for reset that COVID-19 has brought. I think it was Barack Obama's chief of staff, Rahm Emanuel, who said, "You never want a serious crisis to go to waste." And there is something in that, I think, about the important opportunity and responsibility to engage on climate crisis now in a new way. So asking, what can we embrace from the very real changes and challenges of COVID-19 that enables us to set a new course on sustainability in the way that is so essential for our future? So it couldn't be more timely, I think, to get together now. And Jenny, who's leading us, is a senior project engineer at Network Rail and part of the Chaplaincy Plus network, and she's had to engage with flooding and landslips in her work and is passionate about engaging in the Birmingham workplace on what steps we can take to take positive action on sustainability. Jenny, thanks so much for agreeing to lead this session, and over to you.
Okay, thank you. So I am going to share my screen so you can all see it. Welcome, thank you. I've been introduced, so I shall move speedily on to the next slide. So when we think about where we are now, I think very carefully about what William Beveridge did in 1942. What he did there was he was asked to look at the problems they were facing at the time and determine what he could do, what we could do as a society to make things work better. He was originally only asked to look at social insurance, but he actually looked a lot wider than that, at the systemic issues being faced by the UK in the 1940s, and he identified five giants of want, ignorance, disease, squalor and idleness. Now, we probably wouldn't call them that, those things today, but actually quite a lot of those issues do have reared their ugly heads again 75 years later. And what's really interesting is the way that that time to think during the crisis about what you want the world to look like afterwards paved the way for Clement Attlee's government in 1945. And to be honest, without Clement Attlee, we wouldn't have the NHS. And I think the current crisis would be so much more difficult if we were in the situation that the America finds itself in without public healthcare. So I guess the whole frame for today is an opportunity to think about what our own Beveridge report might look like. The RSA, of which I'm a member, joined together with YouGov and undertook a piece of research a few weeks ago about what we think, what the public wants to see after COVID-19. And what's interesting is there is a substantial majority who wants to see the changes that we've all experienced and which came across really clearly in your responses to my questions at the beginning when you signed up for the event. Every single person on this call has reported that you've experienced significant change in the last 2 months, and that has been mixed, you know, some of it good, some of it bad. 85% of the British public want to see some of those changes, the good ones, continue afterwards. And less than 10% want to go back to what it was like before the pandemic. So some of the benefits that people have seen have been around local community and being more in touch with family. 1 in 10 have tried sharing something with a neighbour. People have tried joining, getting food delivered with veg boxes and things like that. half the people that surveyed said that they'd noticed the air being cleaner and that they could breathe more easily, and a quarter have seen more wildlife. So when we're talking about the sorts of changes we want to see, these are the sorts of things I had in mind. So an overview of what we're going to look at today is, firstly, why do we want to say change? So there's a bit of personal context here, and then the global context. Now we're going to look at imagining what that change could look like in your workplace. And I'm going to share three examples of rail people who have managed to imagine a slightly different way of doing things for project delivery, for maintenance, and and for innovation. And that's partly because there are various people from BCRRE on the call who are very excited about hydrogen trains. And then finally, we're going to look at how. How do we actually make the changes that we want to see happen? And as Kim mentioned, there will be two exercises that will have you off into little breakout rooms. And that'll give you the chance to talk to some of the other people on this call and hopefully get something out of being in a smaller group. I have tried this on previous Zoom calls and it's worked really well, and we did a practice last week, so I hope it you get something out of that, and thank you if you haven't tried it before. So, personal context, I graduated in 2008. The year before then, Wakefield Westgate was really badly flooded. You can see that on the screen. The consequence of that was that one of my biggest jobs, my biggest schemes in my first job at Jacobs, was the Ingsbeck Flood Alleviation Scheme. And over a course of 3 years, I built two new dams, including the one that you can see in the middle there. And at the end of 2012, we were allowed to start operating it. The thing that really bothered me was that, having built something that was intended to protect Wakefield from flooding for the next 100 years, the dam that I'd just built was nearly overtopped 3 days after we started operating it. So that's really when climate change and the damage it can do came home to me. In the same year, the railway was also struggling. And the picture to the right of the screen is at Preston Le Skern in the northeast. A job which we've now planned some significant works in the next couple of years to strengthen that embankment against the next time that the surrounding land looks like a lake rather than a field. Another time that really brought the climate crisis home to me was shortly after I started working for Network Rail. I started in October 2015 in the ground engineering team, and I was responsible for looking after slope stability. And we had Storm Dennis, Storm Eva, and Storm Frank between November and January 2016. So the northeast of England got an absolute battering in terms of how much water we had to cope with. One of my colleagues, Susan, was up in the northeast already dealing with a smaller landslip. And on the day that this picture happened, we had her on speakerphone while she told us, "I've just watched a tree float past me." And that particular landslip cost us about £3 million to fix and about 6 months. And the line was shut for 3 weeks, having moved most of the hillside as a result of groundwater issues. However, it's not all bad. I have tried very hard to make sure that in my career I haven't just been picking up the pieces, I also want to make things better. I've had the privilege of working on Manchester Metrolink and done a bit of ground engineering for every new tram line in Manchester since 2008. And a couple of weeks before lockdown started, I managed to open a new station at Worcestershire Parkway. So that's my personal why as to why I care about this. The global why is going to be covered in the next couple of slides. So the climate catastrophe can be summarised very simply. We're putting too much carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. We've been doing that since the beginning of the Industrial Revolution. We're putting more and more in every year, and the temperature is going up as a result. The impact of that on our infrastructure and our resilience is that things that used to be unusual events are becoming more frequent, and we're seeing events far exceeding what we've seen before. So all of the things that we've designed for are likely to be exceeded. And from a ground engineering point of view, this is a graph that's available on the British Geological Survey website under landslides. And they've plotted number of landslides reported in the UK every year with the rainfall from the Met Office. And as you can see, the amount of rainfall we've been getting and the extreme events we've seen happening on an increasing basis are certainly keeping me and my colleagues in the ground engineering business busy. However, I would really rather not be busy. I would rather be making things better rather than trying to pick up the pieces from the wreckage that we've just created. And what does it feel like? Well, the first picture is Worcester. At the same time that I was opening a brand new station, the middle of Worcester was flooded. So I'm not sure whether the £22 million that the County Council had spent building that station will have the desired effect in helping that economy recover. I really hope so. In July last year, Europe saw its worst heat wave in, well, since forever, actually. And the red areas that you can see on the graph illustrate places which were between 7 and 9 degrees higher over a 5-day period than that it would normally be. And that's the sort of thing that's very difficult to adapt to. And then the picture on the right requires no explanation. If you live in Australia, you have lived with wildfires at the end of the summer period all your life. But you've never had a summer like we've just had, where this fire started almost as soon as the end of spring came round. But to be honest, it's not just the climate that's the problem. We also want to be able to breathe some clean air. And we know that transport represents well over half of the toxic air that we breathe, which is good because that's something we can do something about. Particularly when you look at the 250,000 journeys made just in Birmingham every year that are less than a mile in length, and yet people make them by car. We can change that. And then we've also got the situation of looking after the natural world. We are seeing a huge number of water bodies degraded, and a large number of habitats are not fulfilling their functions. And those habitats tend to be quite isolated so that the wildlife cannot spread from one area to another. So we need to adopt the principles in the Lawton report for making sure that our habitats are bigger, better, and more joined up. And the railway can actually play a part in that, which I'll talk about later. So in terms of the facts, we've got around 8,500 species in the UK, one in seven of which is at risk of extinction, which I, for one, find absolutely horrifying. And unfortunately, in the last 10 years, one in three species in the UK have decreased in number. And of the most important protected or priority species, you can see in the graph here what we're seeing in terms of it reducing year on year in terms of how often we're seeing these species and how many of them there are. And finally, we have the social impacts of all of this. So when we say we want to value key workers, we're talking not just about the police and the fire brigade and the health workers, we're also talking about the people who work in care homes on minimum wage. We're also talking about the cleaners. We're talking about the shop workers and the delivery cyclists who don't even have a permanent contract and don't get paid the living wage. So these are all of the sorts of issues that give us pause for thought and a desire to make sure that our post-COVID world is a better one than we had before. So over to you now. What I'd like you to do is to describe, get in your breakout room, you'll have 5 minutes and you'll be with a group of 3 or 4 people. And I want you to think a bit about when you have experienced the power or beauty of nature, perhaps quite recently in your daily exercise, and at a time when you've come face to face with how we're disrupting natural systems. Okay, enjoy. Okay, so I hope you found that useful. We're now going to have a look at how do we create the change that we want to see. So I really wanted to highlight this book from Rob Hopkins, who founded the Transition Towns movement with a real emphasis on people coming up with local solutions together. Because the thing is that people don't need new facts, they need a new story. They need to be able to see how their imagination can help them create something better. And he really focuses on the way that we spend a lot of time catastrophizing. We think about the worst that could happen, but what we don't do is spend time imagining what happens if it turns out okay. What does that look like? What does the world that we want to create feel like? How does it smell? If we can't look at things as if they could be otherwise, it seriously dents our ability to make them otherwise. So I'm going to share a couple of examples from my workplace of people who have looked at a problem in a different way and asked a powerful question about a specific way in which that could be different. So the first example is project delivery. I'm looking at Birmingham New Street, which you'll all be familiar with through going through it, even if you're not familiar with the project that brought it about. Then we're going to look at maintenance and operations. And finally, we're going to look at innovation. So Birmingham New Street was the first time Network Rail had ever done a project that used BREEAM, which is a Buildings Research Establishment Environmental Assessment Framework. And it achieved a very good rating. And setting out to achieve that from the start of the design meant that that £650 million project in the UK's busiest station outside London is entirely powered from a district heating scheme, which also shares heat and electricity with John Lewis and quite a lot of Birmingham City Centre, including the Aston University and Birmingham Children's Hospital. Only 2% of the waste that was produced from taking down the old station and putting a new one in ended up going to landfill, when about 50% of construction waste historically has ended up in landfill. And 60% of the water that is needed in order to flush the station toilets comes from the roof. You know, it's harvested from rainwater and supplied through to the loos. So taking just a very simple question, why don't we try using BREEAM on this project, has resulted in massive, massive benefits that didn't cost anything more to achieve. It just required going about it in a different way. So if we step from big projects now down to the nitty gritty of just keeping the bloody thing running, what if we changed how we think about trees? So this picture here shows that in the 1950s, it was really easy to work out what you did about trees. You didn't have any. Kept everything cut down to grass level because otherwise the steam trains would set fire to it. However, further down the line, we now have some pretty old trees, and some of them are very much appreciated by local people. These trees here near Bradford upon Avon, under traditional vegetation management techniques, would have taken them out. But we haven't. We've come up with an alternative using monitoring and regular inspections to make sure that we can keep them in place without endangering the trains that need to run next to them. And in a similar way, we're looking at how to potentially reduce the amount of clear cutting we do and put a sensitive alternative planting back. If trees are not appropriate in that location, we want to make sure that it's not completely free of vegetation. It's just got vegetation that works. And if we change the mindset, you start looking around and thinking, we've got 6.5 million trees. We've got 16,000 miles of land lineside, and we're one of the UK's biggest landowners. What if we regarded our trees as a national habitat asset that joined up all of those little bits of habitat and made it possible for wildlife to move from one place to another? It's a big mindset shift, but it doesn't have to cost more. And in fact, the Varley report has offered an opportunity for us to really get to grips with what this looks like and come up with a better way of managing vegetation, which is now being embedded in our maintenance operation. And then finally, on innovation, ask Stuart Hillmanson there, and he worked with the folks at the Birmingham Rail Research and Education Centre to look at hydrogen powertrains. And the thing is, he'd already done the calcs. He'd done a lot of research about hybrid vehicles, and the modelling showed it ought to work. But how can you actually make it work? Well, first of all, you build a prototype. This is the Hydrogen Hero, the UK's first hydrogen powertrain, and it was shown off to everybody at Rail Live in 2008. And then, following that, we've now fitted hydrogen power to a real commuter train with Porterbrook. And that is now undergoing testing on the UK network and will be entering service in the near future. So taking things from modelling through to practical application obviously requires a huge amount of partnership working, but it can be done. And that means that the locations that we haven't managed to electrify yet, we can still stop using diesel trains and use a clean power source instead. So I want to ask now, what does a what-if situation look for your business today? So you'll be put in groups of three. I'd like you to imagine that you've made a change. Could be a really small one, but you just asked a sensible question about a way that you could do things differently. Imagine what it looks like when you've made the change and how you did it. Spend a couple of minutes writing and making notes about what that looks like from a personal point of view, and then in your groups, you'll get the chance to discuss it and get some feedback from others in the group about how you can make your idea better. And hopefully this gives you the chance to get some real life feedback and help you develop an idea that you could then implement. Okay, get to it. Good, I hope you can now see my screen again.
Yeah.
Right, yeah. Brilliant. I shall continue, and I will do my very best to finish somewhat on time, but we are running a little bit late. Apologies. If you do have to leave at 2 for other things, please feel free to do so. I will bring it to a close as quickly as I can, but there will be a chance for Q&A afterwards, and you're welcome to stay as long as you can. Okay, so how do we make change that sticks? The first thing I'd say is get a lot of people involved and help them understand what it is that they can do to help you make the change. So the picture I've got here is a technical guide that was written by some folks in Berlin who had introduced temporary cycle routes during the COVID crisis. And that guidance is now being used worldwide by a whole load of other people who want to do that too, including in the UK. And you might have spotted there was something about that in Boris Johnson's announcement yesterday. There's actually some funding for this. So I would suggest that one of the first things you could do to help you make the change you've just described is find something that's relevant to your industry and read it. So for rail people, the Decarbonisation Task Force report is an absolute blinder of a report, and I massively recommend it. If you're an architect, the REBA Architects Declare resources are fantastic. I would love to know what the equivalents are for lawyers and accountants, because we've got quite a few of those on the call, and also councils and housing people. So please put those resources in the chat if you know what other people might find useful. So how do we get people involved in making a change, and how do we make that change stick? The first thing we've got to bear in mind is we need something that is really easy to join in with and reaches out across your whole organisation. You don't just want the really engaged people, the active allies. You want people who vaguely support you, but don't really know what to do about it. You want people who are neutral, and you also want people who would resist it unless you win them over, you know? You're probably not going to manage to get the active opponents involved, but everybody else should be part of your coalition. And what that means is you want to be focused on things that are high participation and easy and fun to join in with. We do not want a purity test, all right? So if people start saying things like, well, I bet you never drive anywhere, or I bet you fly on your holidays, we're not trying to test the purity of the people involved in our organisation. We are trying to help them make a change. John Wesley said, if your heart is with my heart, then take my hand. I don't care about your politics. I don't care about your purity. I just want to help you be in a movement with me. So the other thing to look at is the pillars of power, all right? Every single regime or status quo is propped up by a whole range of different things. We've seen that in the COVID crisis. We couldn't be where we are today without the NHS and the schools and the shop workers and the transport industry and the media, okay? So that means that if you want to make a change happen in your organisation, you need to work out who are the stakeholders who are keeping the existing situation in force and how can you win them over. The second thing to look at is about values, because if you build a movement based on shared values, those values stick. So if you think about South Africa and apartheid, that was built on the values of making a country that was good, not only for black people, but also for white people. And that shaped the whole government afterwards. So when we're talking about building back better, for us, I would suggest our values need to be looking at nature, making habitats which are bigger, better and more joined up. Energy, transport and materials need to be low carbon, adaptable and reusable. And for people, we need a society which is fairer and greener. So we need a different kind of economy that's built around making people and nature thrive. Because it's so, so easy to be characterised otherwise as being people who only care about green things or fluffy things. We've got to care about the people too. And then when we have managed to make a change, don't think you've won yet. You haven't. You've only won when that change is stuck. And you've got to be prepared for a backlash. So in order to understand that, you need to think about the balance of power in different situations. And I've been fascinated over the COVID experience by reading a couple of books, one of which was The Narrow Corridor, which produces this rather lovely graph on the left-hand side. I don't think you can read the text on there, but effectively what it shows is that places which have a balance between the power of the state and its capacity to do what is needed and the power of society to provide oversight of the state, those are the places that thrive. If the state has all the power and society has none, then you have a despotic environment, you've got tyranny. And if you have all the power with society, but no capacity to get anything done, that doesn't get you anywhere. What you need is both. So as we see changes happening in society, we need to make sure that we support them with the right oversight. And we must make sure that we get involved in being that oversight and we don't leave somebody else to make the change, basically, because you can't guarantee that that change is going to work for everyone if you don't get involved. And at organisational level, there's a fantastic book called Strong and Weak by Andy Crouch. And he writes about the way that as leaders, the best place that we can be as leaders and as communities is in the top right hand side of that little four quadrant graph on the right hand side. When you have authority, it means that you have the capacity to make meaningful change. When you are vulnerable, it means that you have the capacity to experience meaningful risk. And the thing is that if you have just authority and no vulnerability, then you're in a position where you're probably abusing that power. And there'll be somebody else in the bottom right-hand quadrant who is suffering as a result because they don't have the power to change, but they're very vulnerable. What we want to do is to bring people up and to the right. We want to bring them into flourishing. And in terms of the research supporting this, there's a great book by Jim Collins, Good to Great, and he studied what made companies great, how they managed to sustain significant overachieving effectively for more than a decade in their particular industry. And he found these things that he called level five leaders. And they were characterized by humility, modesty, and a ferocious resolve to do whatever needs to be done to make the company great. And that reminded me of someone else who advocated servant leadership. Jesus said that the rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them. They abuse their power and they exercise authority over you. But that's not what you're here to do. Whoever wants to be great among Christians needs to be a servant-hearted leader, needs to have that vulnerability alongside the authority. And so I'm just going to finish by looking at how we can look after ourselves and how we can look after each other. So Adam Grant wrote about giving and taking, and this book absolutely blew my mind when I read it, because it helped me see that it's not just a choice between people being selfish and only looking after themselves, and people being completely selfless and giving all that they've got, but at the expense of looking after themselves. Actually, the most successful givers are the ones who give and receive, the ones who make sure that there is a balance. And it is entirely possible and very successful to be the sort of person who cares about other people and cares about looking after yourself. He also found that the most innovative people are the ones who give and receive a lot of help from each other. I wanted to make sure that we make space for grief and lament, because it's really difficult at the moment for a lot of people, and everybody has lost something. So we need to be careful that we don't come across as gloating when we're trying to make a change. Some people are not ready for change yet, and we've got to make sure that we're sensitive. And finally, I'd like to just leave us thinking about what it means to be productive and compare that to what we get from the word fruitful instead. Because if we're looking at a regenerative rather than an extractive economy, what we're saying is we plant things, we water them, we help them grow. And when they're ready, that's when you harvest. Whereas to me, a productive often gives that sense of stress and guilt and I've got to get it all done today. I would suggest that the changes that we're trying to make, we're trying to be fruitful. And you've got to bear in mind that you're probably not going to get the harvest straight away, but that's okay. And Henry Nguyen gave this, we are called to be fruitful, not successful, not productive, not accomplished. Success comes from strength, stress, and human effort. Fruitfulness comes from vulnerability and the admission of our own weakness. So there we have it. And I have finished bang on 2 o'clock, leaving no room at all for questions. I'm very sorry.
Thanks very much, Jenny. Really appreciate that. I know that people would have found that extremely helpful and challenging. Thank you to all of you that came and have hung on till this moment. So I just want to say, I'll send out an email shortly with some questions on. If you could just hit reply on that email, answer the feedback questions for me, that'd be great. It should take you about a minute to do that. So it's very simple. And also on there, I'm going to mention a couple of events that we've got coming up, including a mental health first aiders forum. We've got 10 spaces left on our next one of those for Birmingham, and also an understanding bereavement in the workplace workshop, which is happening on the 1st of June. So I'll drop that onto the email, but do please tick the box if you want to find out more about either of those two, or if you want to join Chaplaincy Plus Network or get more information from us. So thank you so much for coming. As Jenny said, we're hanging out here for a little bit longer. So those of you that want to hang out with us and chat or ask questions, please do that if you're able to stop. And this talk will be available online shortly. Again, if I can get it edited and up, I'll try to put a link onto the email I send out, although timing may not work. So, but thank you so much for coming. I do appreciate it. Can we all just give Jenny a round of applause? I don't know if that works on Zoom. We can give her a... there we go.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jenny. Really appreciate it. And good to see you all.
Thank you.
Cheers.